Welcome, friends, to the second day of our meditation workshop here in Menominee, Wisconsin. I welcome you again. Yesterday, I mentioned to you the limitations of meditation, that meditation is a mental exercise because it involves effort. It involves the operation of our egos. The I has to do meditation. If the I is not there, you cannot meditate. Therefore, if I is the problem, if the mind is the obstacle, meditation cannot cross it. But meditation is good up to a point. Meditation can take us to discoveries of other realities besides our physical reality. Meditation can show us that the nature of this universe is different than what we think it is. That the cause of the universe is not outside but inside us. These are some things that we can realize through meditation. We can also realize and solve some big problems which are being faced by scientists about the nature of time and space and so on. Meditation can give us answers to those questions. But it cannot take us beyond the mind to where we belong as souls, where we belong as consciousness, where we belong as totality of everything, where we belong to our original state of being, where we belong to our original home. It cannot take us there. It has never taken us. Therefore, people who have been relying only on meditation, including several masters that I have met, several yogis, several swamis, they have regarded the universal mind, the top of the causal plane, as our true home. And they have realized that all the creation we can know of here arises from there. Therefore, from their point of view, that is where we belong. But that is not true, because as I mentioned yesterday, we have some functions going on in us which go beyond that. What could be the relationship, if any, between the different realities that I spoke of? And any realities even beyond the mind? Do you see any connection at all? When we go into the dream state, we lose the awareness of the wakeful state. There is no connection. When we go into higher state of the astral consciousness, or what we I simplified by calling it the imaginative consciousness, when we go to that level, we lose the awareness of the physical awareness. When we go to the mental awareness, total mental awareness, we lose the awareness of the other realities. What is the connection? You must have noticed one thing does connect all these. The self is the same. The self that we experience, which we experience right now, is the same self in the dream state, same self in the wakeful state, same self in the astral state, same self in the causal state. At least we have one clue that if we were to pursue the self, we can find a connecting link between the different realities and different states of consciousness. Is there any other way to connect the self through all these different levels of realities and consciousness? Yes, there is. And that's a very beautiful discovery, that the self at every state has a radiance of its own, a musical radiance, a sound current, something that can be heard at the physical level, that can be experienced in the dream state, and can be heard in the astral state, and can be heard and seen at the causal state. That's a big connection. Self is being expressed in a different way and continues to be expressed like that. And I am going to share with you that the same connection of the self keeps on moving not only through these states but even beyond the mind. Because this musical radiance of the self is not confined to the mind at all. It's not a mental activity at all. No ego is involved in that. No effort is involved in that. There's a sound in each one of us that resounds. The only secret is to put attention on it. If our attention is somewhere else, that's the nature of attention. If our attention is continuously on the affairs of the world, the sound does not appear to be existing. If the attention goes inward to the self, nowhere else, not to the sound, to the self, the sound appears. The sound is a manifestation of the self. That's a very beautiful discovery, that there is something that emanates from the self other than the experience of the self, which can be caught by us, and that can be virtually a connecting link between all levels of awareness, and we can ride on it even beyond the mind. We call that connecting link as the very basis of our experiences, because the connecting link generates what we call ourself. It is an expression of the self and also the generator of the self. That is why it has been praised so much by mystics all around the world. In the Bible, John describes it as the Word. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. I don't see any clearer definition of God than the one expressed by John. The Word was God. Now that was, the Bible was composed 250 years after the passing away of Jesus Christ. But the ancient Vedas in India, composed by Ved Vyas, in the spiritual part of that Vedas called the Rig Veda, it says the origin of the universe, the origin of experience itself, is from the nad, the sound. In more recent times, it's been called the shabd, the sound, the word. Shabd can mean sound and word at the same time in more than one language. Subud. It has been explained in so many times. In every religion, in the original text of those religions, you will find the mention of this amazing experience which connects us virtually to the creative power, to the creator, the God himself. So that is a very big thing. That is why if we want to really connect ourselves to all levels of experience, even the one beyond our mind, we can discover where we find this sound, where we find this wonderful connection, connecting all levels of consciousness. And then we can discover that if we connect with that sound, we can discover our own reality even beyond the mind. This connection of the sound, why is it called sound? When we say word, what is word? Word is merely an English language word, which means just one of the words that we speak. How can a spoken word become God? How can a shabd become the creative power? How can a sound represent the reality more than what we are experiencing? It looks ridiculous on the face of it. That's simply a sound. We make sounds all the time. We hear sound all the time. How can sound be a reality? The answer is very strange. The answer is, it is not sound. It is the whole creative power of all creation. We call it sound because at the physical human state where we are sitting now, it can be heard. That's all. It's not sound otherwise. It's a creative power that creates everything. At that level, you can never call it sound. It's more than God, more than creative power. It's everything. It's totality. Therefore, totality means nothing is outside of it. And yet, we call it sound because the same power is manifesting in every reality and coming to our human level, at this physical level, and we can hear it. It is audible. That's the only reason why we call it sound. When we describe that sound, we describe it in relation to other sounds. For example, I am speaking to you now. This is also sound. My voice, my language is all in a sound. We call it a sound that can be spoken and written. In the Indian original language, they were calling it Varanatmak Shabd. Varanatmak Shabd. That the Atma, the self, is being expressed in something that can be varnan, can be explained by writing or by speaking. A good explanation. That's what I'm using now. I'm using Varanatmak Shabd, which can be written and spoken. We are given mantras to repeat just to control the flow of our mental thoughts, also Varanatmak Shabd. Every word we speak, no matter what language, is all Varanatmak Shabd. That can be spoken. It's still sound. But a sound at the level where it's become audible to us in the physical state. We as seekers of the ultimate truth have access to the sound, which at this time is being expressed as Varanatmak Shabd. If we didn't hear about the truth, the way we are placed in this physical universe, even though we were seekers, if there is no one coming to tell us what it is, we'll be left blind and left without knowledge. Therefore, Varanatmak Shabd has a great importance. That is why we read books, we listen to people, and we discover where we have to seek our truth within ourselves. Truth is within ourselves. We listen to somebody outside because we don't listen to ourselves inside. Our attention, which is supposed to listen, whenever you are putting your attention on what I'm saying now, we don't put attention inside to what the self is saying. Therefore, somebody else tells us from outside what to listen to inside. The outside Varanatmak Shabd is merely a means to get to know that we have to listen to something beyond listening outside, listen to something inside. How do we listen inside? One simple way. If this sound inside is coming from the self, put your attention on the self. Sound can be heard. If you put your attention anywhere else, sound is not heard. As it happens, in meditation, we do practice listening to sound. So many people talk about the reality being light and sound. They distinguish as if light is something different from sound because our sense perceptions have been divided in the physical world. In the causal world, there is no difference between light and sound. They are the same thing. Sound is lighted up and light is ringing a sound. So therefore, we are in a very, very primitive state of understanding the sound, where we want to just listen to the sound as we know it. Sound of music, sound of bells, sound of other instruments that we are used to. Sound of words becomes Varanatmak, but what about other sounds? Those are not words. They don't carry any meaning that the words carry, but we like them. Therefore, when we listen to the sound of the self within ourselves, we call it a different type of sound, a sound with a melody, sound with a dhun, what they call it. And the Varanatmak Shabd then converts itself into Dhunatmak Shabd. The difference is simple. One can be spoken and read, other can be heard and enjoyed. Which we do all the time outside, why not do it inside? As it happens, when we try to listen to the sound of the self, if we are able to capture the central part of ourself, as I explained yesterday, sitting behind the eyes, between the ears and the wakeful state, if we can put our attention there, sound comes very quickly. But there are other sounds in the body also. They are bodily sounds. They are sound of the nerves. When you put too much attention, every sound can be heard. You can hear other kinds of sounds also. So, if the practice of listening to the sound is important, it is also important to remember that there are many sounds that can be heard inside. And we have to distinguish between the sound of the self and the sound that is being created by other factors in the body. Sounds can be like thunder, drums. People hear many kinds of sounds. Sound of chirping of birds, chirping of crickets, sound of rain, sound of thunder. Many sounds can be heard just by putting attention to the self. The closer you are to the self in putting your attention, the more likely you are to hit upon the sound of the self. This path of discovering ourselves through the sound, through the shabd, has been called Surt Shabd Yoga. The kind of practice that great master Baba Sawan Singh taught me. I examined many paths, and I can tell you, at age 92, going to be 93 in November, I have had some experience, initiation for more than 83 years, I can tell you that there is no better method I could find to discover the self than the method of listening to the sound of the self. Therefore, I commend, examine all methods of putting your attention on the self, and see, the sound of the self will be the easiest at this time. That is why Surt Shabd Yoga. Surt means attention. Shabd means sound. Yoga means union with your true self. So that is why this path of listening to the sound within is the key to go to the connecting link between things that are not of the mind, not of the ego, not of effort, but something that's just ringing inside, and you enjoy it. This kind of sound that comes here, the dhunatmak sound, is not words, but you can also hear words. At the astral level, your mind can think in words like it thinks here, and can also hear the sound. Both coexist. Even at the physical level, we can hear the sound, and we can also talk. We can use both types. So dhunatmak shabd and the varanatmak shabd are available to us at these three levels, the levels of creation. But they change. What happens in this state? We are using varanatmak shabd. When we say, do your meditation as I recommended yesterday, start from the inside, not here. The main reason for my suggesting that was, people have been doing meditation, the physical body, with physical consciousness, physical head, all their time in their mind, and made no progress. When you start from inside, you are starting with a progress already. Now, if you start with the progress inside, you are using varanatmak shabd inside also. But when the sound can be heard by putting attention on your own self at the center, what has been described as third eye center. Why was this expression used? It used to bother me. Why you call it third eye center? We know third eye. We have only two eyes. But then, when the explanation was given to me, why it's called third eye, I began to appreciate it. The reason why it's called third eye is because these two eyes cannot see what we are seeing outside. These two eyes see two different pictures. They are placed separately, so there is no way that the two eyes can see the same thing. This feature is being used when making 3D movies, where they put two pictures on the screen and give you glasses to wear which combine the screen, and it looks like 3D. We are creating 3D the same way with these two eyes. Where are we creating it? If two eyes are having two different pictures, the retina is carrying two different pictures, the optic nerve is receiving two different pictures, where are we combining them? Where do we feel we are seeing? If you examine, when you look at things and the three dimension is there, where do we combine the two? We combine behind the eyes at the very point which we call the third eye center. We are using the third eye center every day. Every day by looking out with the two eyes, we are using the third eye center to combine the images, and that's what we are seeing. Therefore, third eye center only means that there is an eye where we combine. That's why it's called the third eye. We are using it all the time, even now. But it's a very good place, because where it combines is exactly the seat of the self in the wakeful state in a physical body. So that is why it's very useful to know that where we are combining. If when we close our eyes and we imagine something, we imagine we are seeing a picture in front of us. We imagine we are seeing a mountain. Pure imagination. Where do we see it? It's in front of us, a mountain. Where are we seeing that mountain? In imagination. Third eye center. Imagination works at third eye center. Vision works at third eye center. Our feeling, where are we operating from in the body? Third eye center. So that is why this center of consciousness in the wakeful state has been described as third eye center. The self in the wakeful state is operating from there. Therefore, if we can put our attention on that center, how do we put attention on something? That's another problem. Big problem. Very big problem. I want to put attention on a paper. I am carrying a paper to put attention on it. And I say, now the paper is on this side. I am looking this side. But I can put attention on it even without seeing it. I can move it. But the best attention is if I place it in front of me. If I place it in front of me, I am putting attention. What am I experiencing? I am experiencing myself, paper, and attention. Three things. I am putting attention on the paper, therefore I am experiencing myself. Otherwise, I won't have attention if I don't know who I am. I am there looking at the paper, therefore three things are happening. I, the self, looking, attending to, putting attention on paper, three things. No matter how hard I put attention on the paper, it will never be attention on myself. No matter how close I bring it to myself, it can never be attention on myself. Therefore, putting attention on anything other than the self will never be attention on yourself. And I'm emphasizing this point because our whole idea of putting attention on something is to put attention on something other than yourself. You are the one to put attention, therefore you can't be putting attention on yourself. Very big problem. We are used to putting attention, if I say put more attention, focus on it. That's another word, focus on it. This error of thinking that by putting attention on something, we are putting attention on ourselves, comes up very strongly in meditation. When we say put attention on yourself, we are so used to putting attention on something other than ourselves, we try to make an image of ourselves and put attention on it. That's not ourselves. The self is the one that's putting attention on the image we are making of ourselves. People try to see them sitting inside and looking at it, saying, I'm putting attention on myself. No, you are putting attention on something you are creating by your imagination. But the one who is doing it is the one you have to put attention on. This is a very big problem. Not as easy as we think. Focusing attention does not allow you to put attention on yourself, no matter how hard you try. The only way to put attention on yourself is to withdraw attention, not focus, not put on anything. Withdraw attention from everything to yourself. Withdrawal of attention is very different from putting attention on anything. We have spent our whole life putting attention on things. And we use the same formula when trying to put attention on ourselves. Withdrawal of attention is very different from putting attention on something. Very big roadblock for many people who are meditating. Very big roadblock. They have learned how to put attention on things, never learned how to withdraw attention from everything. To withdraw attention, not easy. But there's an easier way. Easier way is that the self, which is trying to do this withdrawal, you can imagine where the self is. That's the easiest way to withdraw attention, to imagine where am I. When you say where am I in the head, you're automatically withdrawing attention to yourself. You're asking where you are. That is why the easiest way to withdraw attention is to imagine and locate, where am I in the head? So when we try to figure out imaginatively, where am I, the withdrawal process starts. Since we are not used to it, it takes time. Be patient, but that's necessary. If you want to put attention on the self and to want to hear the sound of the self, you have to be patient till you learn to reverse this method of focusing attention on things and now withdrawing attention to yourself. When you withdraw attention to yourself, you imagine where you are, that's exactly where you are. Because you are imagining your own self, where am I? Supposing you just imagine that you are in the head, but not separate. Not imagine I'm seeing myself. No, if you start seeing yourself, then you are away from yourself. When you are imagining, I am functioning there, like I made you do a little bit, I am standing up, I am sitting down. That imagination was of yourself, not of looking at anything. You were not looking at anything. You were getting up and sitting up and down. The activities you are doing behind the eyes of what you are doing yourself is a withdrawal of attention to yourself. Easiest way. But this switch is very necessary. The switch from focusing attention on something we are used to withdrawal of attention to yourself. When you withdraw attention to yourself, you will notice that the more you are putting attention on yourself, what you are doing inside, the closer you get to the sound of the self. And the sound of the self is different from the other sound. The quality of its melody is so beautiful. It rings in a way, it resembles the sound of a bell. No wonder the churches all put bell frees. No wonder bells are rung in temples. No wonder bells are used everywhere. Just symbolic. Symbolic that the sound of the self, when we start listening to it, will resemble the sound of a bell. But the bell has a little hard sound because it has to ring. Dong, then the gong starts. Again, it has to hit. The sound of the bell inside has no hit like that. It's continuously a melody of the movement of the peal of the sound. That peal of the sound, when it comes, because our attention goes slowly inside, the mind is fighting. The mind is trying to draw attention to many other things outside, happening outside, and even inside. Is that the sound coming? Is that the right sound? Is it on the right ear? My left ear? The sounds on the ears cannot be the sound of the self at all. It's not a physical sound. Physical sounds can be distinguished. People sometimes say, I'm hearing the sound of the bell when they've got just a simple case of tinnitus. Just a medical problem of the ears. That is not the sound. It's too harsh. It's bothersome. And that's so pleasing. It's so wonderful. You enjoy it. That is why it takes some time, some practice to reverse this whole practice of focusing attention on things and then withdrawing attention to yourself using the power of imagination that you are there doing this and sound comes. When it comes and you send sound, it is truly, you can forget about any repetition of any word. You can forget all the varanatmak shabd you ever used. The sound alone is enough. It captures you, and when you listen to it, automatically when we listen attentively, we are drawn to it. Listening attentively to that sound automatically brings you to yourself and awakens you to a better state of knowing what is around than we are sitting here knowing. As yet we are doing it in the physical body. But when you put attention on the sound, the inner self becomes more and more real, and your withdrawal of attention from the body is hastened. I have found no method of withdrawal of attention from the body as easily as by putting attention on the sound within. All other methods are very slow. But when you can hear the sound, it pulls you very quickly and you lose the awareness of the body and the inner body becomes your reality. And opens up all the memory of the inner body, opens up the vision of things that are there in that body, opens up new eyes of the body, and the astral self becomes a reality. Therefore, the dhunatmaksha, which emanates from the self, is a very good step. But it doesn't end there. What is the next step from the sound? The same sound, if you put attention on it, enables you to go closer to where you are listening to the sound. Yourself, inner self, has a similar form as this body. Very similar. When we imagine ourselves having the same kind of body as this. Maybe sometime we want to look a little younger. That's all right. The forms can be changed because of imagination. You can become very young, you can become more beautiful, more handsome inside. That doesn't matter, but you're still talking of the self. And when you hear the self and meditate in the head of the self inside, what happens to the sound? The sound that you're hearing, which is drawing you there, pierces into the head of the inner self, and another sound can be heard. That sound is really the sound of the bell. The peals of the bell keep on increasing in length and become one peal. Sometimes they describe it as the sound of a conch, which many yogis are using. That's a continuous sound, slightly different. And while you are having an experience of a sky, which is grey kind of sky, you suddenly start seeing more light, golden kind of light, white light, other kinds of light, which are emanating just by your opening the inner sound, which then is not the same sound. The dhunatmak sound suddenly becomes in meditation of the inner self. When you open up the self beyond your sensory perceptions, the sound changes and looks like this sound you have been hearing all the time. What happened to you? It doesn't look you have started hearing a sound now by coming in. You go, this was always, I was hearing it all the time. I was hearing it for centuries. It never stopped. That's the experience of that inner sound. So even dhunatmak shabd changes and becomes a sound which looks like an endless sound. And the terminology used for that is anhad shabd. Anhad, no boundaries. Unlimited, infinite. It is not the name only. Here we are, everybody talking of these things, infinite things and infinite sounds. But that's an experience. Actual experience that sound was there with you all the time. Where is it coming from? It's coming from the self. Now, the body created into a bell sound. The sense perceptions created into a different kind of sound. And we pierced inside. And the mind, our thinking machine, is filtering the sound of the self and creating the sound as if it is infinite. And there's a reason for that. The reason is the very mind that is creating infinity of space and time is creating the infinity of the sound. That's the causal sound. So it becomes anhadsha. Now, that sound is very different from what we can experience here, totally different from varanatmak shabd and different from dhunatmak shabd. It's a new experience altogether in meditation. When you hear that sound, that's the maximum you can do with meditation and your effort. How do we go beyond that? Beyond that, only another effortless thing happens. Sound, if somebody is playing a music, we can be drawn to it. We don't have to make an effort. If music is playing, if music is there, we just get drawn to it. We don't make an effort to go towards music when music is there. Similarly, there are some other things that happen in life where we are drawn to it without effort. And the most important of those experiences where we are drawn to it without effort is the experience of love. Being pulled by love. When love pulls us, there's no effort involved. It's a pull. We are attracted. We like to follow without trying. If we try, we sometimes try not to be pulled, not to be tried to get pulled. Love is so powerful a force. In a very simple way, in a modified way, we are experiencing it here. In the most crude way, we are being using it as attraction. We are being attracted. That's the crudest way in which the love can be experienced. As love becomes purer, we find it's not attractiveness, because in attractiveness, the duality of the one who is attracting us and ourselves remains. If you are attached to somebody, attracted to somebody, you feel there you are, and there is the object of which you are attracted to, where you are attached to. All attachments always have the awareness of yourself, not necessarily the real self, the ego part of yourself, the mental part of yourself. When people talk to each other, I love you, and you watch what happens. You are aware of I and you all the time. If the you says, I don't love you, I also say, then I also hate you. This is the kind of experiences we still call it love, because the attractiveness of being pulled is still there. But when there is true love, what happens, and we have true love experiences right here in the physical world. When we fall in love truly with somebody, we forget the I, and the only the beloved who pulls us is in our mind. Therefore, the two disappear in true love. In attachments, both remain. That's a very big distinction between attachment and love. In love, we are pulled. And therefore, if love can pull us, there's no effort involved. To go beyond the mind, this is what happens. Love pulls us beyond the mind. Now, where does love come from? What is love? What is the nature of love? Where is it coming from? What is this experience we are having of love? Have we defined it properly? I see hundreds of definitions, mostly defining infatuation, defining attractiveness, defining attachment. Very few defining true love. A true love which can put your ego behind. I was once trying to study. Ego is such a powerful thing, the I-ness, I do this. When surrender, I surrender. I am nobody. I am the humblest of the humble. What a great ego. There is no way to control this ego. I comes all the time. Therefore, is there anything that actually happens in this world where for a moment we forget the I? It is falling in love. For some moment we forget the I. That is why love is a very powerful force. Where does it come from? What's the nature of love? I have seen the answer to this question written on boards everywhere. God is love. If that is true, we are putting love at the highest level of creative power. If the creative power is love, and we are talking of our ultimate journey to the creative power, obviously the love is coming from there. Whose love is it that is pulling us inside? There is nobody inside except ourselves. Our own love pulls us. The love of our total self, the love of the totality of our own self, the love of the ultimate of ourselves, pulls us in the state in which we think we are the self. The love takes us beyond the mind, nothing else. But we have no idea. We are trying to find who we are. We are trying to find first outside who we are, then a little bit inside. We have no idea. All this trying to find is with the mind. Then how will love pull us? When we are seekers, seekers of the truth, seekers of the ultimate truth, seekers of our true self, seekers of God, seekers of the creative power, whatever name you give it, if we are seekers of that, we must have become seekers by some pre-arranged arrangement by which we could find what we are seeking. If we look at the history of our origin, in time and space. We are sitting now as human beings with a certain amount of life here. We might have had previous lives. When did we first come, leave our true home to get this experience? When we had total knowledge. Total knowledge, total awareness, totality was there, and we were part of that, we were that itself. Then how could we come here and make no arrangement to be able to go back? And now we are finding out the method of going back was being pulled by love of the same totality that we were. We could not be that unintelligent not to make an arrangement. Yes, we made an arrangement. And we can only discover what arrangement we made when we go back and see, yeah, this is what worked. When you go back, you find out what the arrangement was. The arrangement was, when we are in these different levels of experiences and we are tired of these experiences, when we feel as the self, we have had enough of it, then we will discover ourselves. But we don't know how to discover ourselves. Therefore, ourselves will be represented by an outside experience, because we are only looking outside. And the outside experience will be the starting point for our inside experience. What is the outside experience that corresponds to what we arrange? That is the appearance in our life of another human being. Because human beings can create and express that love. It happens to us all the time. But we mess it up without thinking too much. So therefore, a human being will appear in our life, prearranged by us. A human being will appear in our life who represents our own true self. It's our arrangement. A human being will appear in our life and give us the experience of true love. Not merely love. True love. Totally unconditional love. With no judgment whatsoever. With no expectations at all. A love that we have not experienced ordinarily. Such a person will appear in our life. And that person will be an ordinary person. Not extraordinary. Ordinary person, but with an extraordinary love. Ordinary person with extraordinary qualities, which normally we don't find. Such a person is actually what we today call a perfect living master. A perfect living master is a representation in our physical world of our own true self. When we call a human being as a perfect living master, we are really making a little mistake, because we are calling another person perfect living master. The perfect living master is our own true self. And the human being is merely a representation of that. How does he represent that? How can a human being represent our own true self? Because our own true self is one totality. It's not divided. And that human being who is appearing in our life is conscious, aware of that totality, which is our totality, that totality, same thing. Therefore, a perfect living master is not somebody who's come to teach us anything. He's not a very learned person. He represents our own true self, arrangement made by our own self to go back to our true home. And when he appears, what does he say? Does he say, come, I'll teach you something? He says, go inside. But we say, we love you. You are outside. He says, go inside and find me inside. I am also inside. We say, but we fall in love with you outside. Go inside, you'll fall more in love with me. And when we follow his instructions, he is more inside than he was outside. More available to us inside than outside. And we fall in love with him inside even more than outside. Then what does he do? He continuously takes us as a companion, as a friend, through these different levels of realities, never leaving us. A great friendship. And that friendship ends up in the totality where we discover What we thought was another human being and nobody but our own self. That's the beauty of this experience. Ultimately, it's love starting from here, love inside, love at the causal plane, love that pulls us beyond. Love is the secret of spirituality. Therefore, I have said many times, the true spirituality is love and devotion. Now, I added one more word. I was talking of love, now put devotion also into it. Why is that? Because devotion is a response to true love. When we experience true love, we become devotees by ourselves. It's not something that we have to do. The devotion comes automatically the more we experience pure love of a perfect living master. Perfect living masters are very rare because seekers of the truth are very rare. There are billions of people living here. Trillions of people living in other levels of realities. Masters are very few because seekers who go to go beyond the mind, very few. What do most people go to masters for? Master, I have a problem of sickness in my house. Master, I have lost my money. Master, all wanting aid in physical reality and solving physical problems. Very few say we want to go in and see what's going on. Those who want to go in only want to see whether heaven's there, whether good things inside. Still, an experience of seeing things. I want to go and have a great flight in the causal plane. Nobody is saying I want to find who I am. I want to find my own reality. Those are rare. Masters are rare. But when you are a seeker of your own true reality, a perfect living master appears in your life. You can never find him. Why can't we find a perfect living master? If a master is meant for us, we should be able to find one. We can't find a perfect living master because he does not come to spread any message for the world. He does not come to reform society. He does not come to make our life better here. He does not come for any of these purposes of the temporal nature or astral nature or causal nature. He comes merely to take us back home as arranged by ourselves at the inception of this whole experience. That is why he does not come dressed up like a teacher, dressed up like somebody who is going to give you something, comes as a friend. The relationship with a perfect living master is a relationship of a friend with true love, pure love. That's how it works. That is why these masters are rare, and we are also rare people who are seeking that ultimate. Many of us might have had many experiences of other realities in past lives. Many of us have had experiences in this life itself. We are not satisfied. Therefore, perfect living masters appear in our life when we are ready to go beyond what we have got. If we have got something, not satisfied, we go beyond. What happens in the meantime? Meantime, we can meet many masters. Our whole concept of reality, of God, of ourself, is so different from what you experience at the end. It's so different. We are separating ourselves. When people worship God, I see many people worshiping God looking upward. Almost give the impression God lives in the skies or somewhere. God lives inside. All religions say that. Kingdom of God is within you. Everything is within you. Why are we looking up in the sky? Who are we praying to? Who are we worshipping? Our whole concept is, one day I will meet God. Do you know, if you go to totality, there's only one. There's no one to meet. You, your true self, and the creative power is identical. Because there cannot be two there. You cannot see God. You can be God. You can realize you are the same power at all times. And it's your manifestation that created a worshipper and a separate one, the mind creates as a God. The soul has never decided to create any God. Mind creates the God. Why is that? Because the mind is the only machine we are using to divide, to separate. Soul does not. We do not. Our self does not. Self combines. Self wants totality. Self wants union. Self wants to be together. Self wants to destroy separation. Mind wants to separate. Mind wants to analyze, not synthesize. It's exact two different functions. That is why we are using the mind to divide ourselves, using the mind even to divide God into different religions. I love my God, not yours. Everybody talking of different God. When I was studying economics, public administration, business at Harvard University, I decided on the side, because it's a big library, Widener library was there, I decided to study comparative religion. So I could see there must be a lot of common things in all religions. 11 religions I studied. And was fascinated by studying how their belief systems are, how their rituals are, how their ceremonies are, how they're supposed to be expressing their knowledge outside in the physical world. But they were all different. There was nothing common. Only common thing I found in those 11 religions was ours was the only real one, all others are fake. Every one of them said the same thing. What a division. It was obvious to me religion has gone way beyond, further down from spirituality. Spirituality says there is one. The founders of religion say there is one. And we practicing religion say there are many. Why, I found that I met a man, he said, I am preparing a Bible composed from 14 Bibles. I said, 14 Bibles? Oh yes, there are different versions of the Bible. Then I began to study history of the Bible. When I studied history of the Bible, it was eye-opening. That the Bible has been revised so many times. Ecumenical councils have come and said, throw away this gospel, put in this gospel. 700 years ago, and throughout history. And I discovered the first time it was written by the scribe. There were no printing presses or something, no telephone, no computer. The scribes would write differently, then they had to get together, they had written different things. Then somebody else would come and tell them how to combine and say, this is the correct way. And when did it happen? More than 100 years after Jesus Christ had already passed. And today we are calling it the Word of God. Have we known that? Do we know in the United States of America, I pick up a Bible, 14th version approved by King James of England. He approved a separate Bible. And that we think is the Word of God today. And I meet my friends who believe in Jesus Christ. I said, well, then let's go to church. No, that's not my church. That's Methodist. That's Baptist. What are we talking about? What have we done to the message of God? What have we done to spirituality? Religion was supposed to be helping us. All that now we talk of is the rituals, the ceremonies we have to do are separate. And there are the religion. That's the work of God. We've forgotten altogether that God is the same. He's inside all of us. And no matter how many names you give to it, it remains the same. And this is a big division. Who does the division? Not the soul. Not the self or mind. Why did this happen? Because the mind was designed to do this. The whole idea of creation was to create the many out of the one. That's why we are so many. So many sitting here. Can we believe we are all one? We try to say, we are one. We are one, but that part I don't like. I hate that one, but otherwise we are one. This is our whole concept of the oneness. We have not experienced oneness because we have used the mind as a constructive thing for dividing, as a constructive machine to generate huge populations, generate differences, analyze, separate. When we use the mind today, we use it for analysis. You have to study something. The easiest way for the mind to study is break it into pieces and analyze what it is, not put it together. Putting it together is done by intuition, separation is done by the mind. These two functions are in us. Intuition, even today, looks at a picture, whole picture. The mind looks at separate pieces. I gave example. I look at these beautiful flowers. It takes 1 second to me to see the beauty of the flower. If I want to see from the mind, how is it beautiful? Oh, I start seeing each piece separately. That's how they function. The two function differently. The soul and mind function differently. That is why soul is expressing itself right here. How? Experience of love, experience of intuition, experience of appreciation of beauty, experience of bliss, experience of being somewhere where we are not. All those experiences the mind cannot create. Soul can, it is creating right here, right inside, right in the causal plane, right in spirituality. So that is why we have to understand the distinction between the mind and the soul. The mind is not the soul. The mind is not ourself. Mind is merely something that we are using for constructing a wonderful, vast experience. Enjoy the show. We created it for enjoying it. Why did we come here? If we were so happy in our true home, some people ask this question. If we were so happy there, why are we here today? We were very happy. We wanted to appreciate the happiness more by very wonderful system called experience of unhappiness. It's a wonderful way. Because we realized consciousness operates in a way where we get an experience more clearly if there's an opposite of that. Supposing there is no opposite, the experience disappears. It's very strange. If you look at this, supposing there was no darkness, for example. Let's say there was always light in this world. A set light, set amount of light, you didn't need any of these bulbs or anything, or any other electric power. There was light all the time here. We would never see that light. You won't even know it exists. Because there is darkness, now we know what is light. Everything you see, people who have never seen poverty have never been able to appreciate their riches. I see them all the time. People who haven't seen pain do not value the pleasure as much. Everything that we are experiencing in this world is in pairs of opposites. That is why the duality has been created, for the very reason, to make the experience real. Therefore, if we were totally in state of bliss and happiness, how did we appreciate we were in state of bliss and happiness? Come down here for a while, then go back. Make sense? That means, if some of our colleagues, our souls, were sitting in the true home, decided not to come here, and we decided to come here, when we go back, what happens? Kabir, one of the mystics, in some of his writings, he says that these who have come here, he calls them Hans. The soul that never left a true home, he calls them Bans. And he says, when the Hans returns to the true home, they dance with so much joy there with what they are experiencing, that the Bans say, what is wrong with you? We are the same people, we are the same souls, we are the same units of consciousness, and we are also in a state of bliss. What is making you so more blissful? And we tell them, you don't know what you are missing. Great justification for the whole creation. If you think of it, that the whole creation, where we went into duality, then how does the state of non-duality? A lot of people tell me reality is non-dual. I said, that's correct. Reality is non-dual. So we create an unreality, look like reality, which is dual. And that becomes the opposite of the region of non-duality. Imagine a region of non-duality can be made into a region of duality by placing a world of created world, which is of duality. The world of duality becomes the opposite of the world of non-duality. That's how it happens. So it's wonderful that it can still, the reality, ultimate reality, can still be non-dual. And yet, a reality created by us, not illusion created by us, a reality created. If it was only illusion, it would not take care of the non-duality. A reality which is non-dual is now being faced by a reality which is dual. And then that becomes the opposite. And we experience our own true self much more in its true essence just by being in this reality which we have created here. It's a wonderful way. If you look at the whole grand picture, you'll see so much perfection in it. If you see small parts of it, it's all imperfect. The totality is perfect. The totality of creation, how these things have been created. We are crying here, we are going through karma, we are going through pain and this thing, we are going through highs and lows. They all have a purpose in the total grand scheme of things. Look at the grand scheme of things, and then you will realize how each little thing happening here is part of a perfect thing, a perfect plan. A perfect plan of our own reality and the realities we have created. It's amazing that the reality has been created by a process which could be called illusion. That is why some people say this is an illusion. If somebody comes and tells me, you know, this is all illusion, I need a very small trick to tell him it is not. A small little pin of it and a poke in him. I did it, by the way. Once a man came to the Dera in Bias, and after listening to great master discourse, he was sitting on a little platform. There was some platform there, and giving his own discourse. I have reached the highest level. His ego was so obvious, the way he was talking. I have done this, I have done this. Perfectly, the masters have never said this, that what they have done. They are so humble. They give credit to their masters for everything. Master is doing it. They never take any credit. And here this man was making this. So I was very young, but maybe a little naughty at that time. Maybe still am. I had a safety pin attached to my handkerchief for use, because sometimes one needed it, and I said, I'll keep it one. So I pulled out my safety pin. When he was saying, I have crossed the mental states beyond the five, he was talking of five naughty boys, which means the, what is it, lust, anger, all those things, five things. He was claiming he has no anger anymore, I have gone above that. So I decided to take out the pin. And as he was giving a discourse, people sitting in front, I poked him. I poked him and ran. I knew he couldn't run as fast as I could run. And I said, where are the five boys now? I still remember saying. The reality has been created by introducing one element called pain. Did you know that? Pain is one of the essential elements that has been created here to make it real. That's why even Shakespeare had to say, there never yet was philosopher who could bear the toothache patiently. He could give all the discourses, but when the dentist wanted to pull his teeth, he said, please. That is why pain and pleasure, opposites, have been created, so that we can experience something in duality and then get out of duality and experience the beauty, the bliss, the wonderful experience of our own true self or true home. Some people are saying to me, what happens if we go to our true home and then we decide to come back again? I said, would you mind if you come back again? Seeing the experience here, we wouldn't mind. I said, imagine this. Supposing you have a bad dream at night. A bad dream. Scary dream. And you are crying in the dream. I'll never like to come here again. And then you wake up. and you say, thank God it was a dream, will you stop sleeping the next day? Or will you still sleep? We sleep every night. Even after a scary dream, we still sleep. Because we know that's not real. We know the level of wakefulness is different from the level of a dream. It was just a dream. When we are in a true home, we realize that all these experiences of realities which look so real to us were actually no more than a dream. This is merely the whole creation is a set of dream within dream within dream. Somebody sent me a copy of a movie called Inception. Some of you might have seen it. Inception, in that they show that you can create a dream world and the time frame is different than a dream world. What impressed me was how accurate, near accurate was their description of the expansion of time in a dream as compared to the wakeful state. In that movie, they say that for 10 minutes sleep, you could experience several hours in the dream life. You could have a lot of events happening and the actual sleep time will 10 minutes. Then if you sleep within a sleep, you could have a whole lifetime of 50 years, whereas in the wakeful state is 10 minutes, first dream is few hours, second dream can be. They went up to third dream. And I realized right now we are in the sixth dream. So we have endless time, infinite time here. When we wake up, the time was much less what was happening here in extended time. When we go to the top, there was zero time. Zero time has expanded to all the nature of time here. So from that point of view, I like the movie. But also, in the movie, they show there's a method of waking up. They carry a little thing in their hand. It looks like something that hurts when you press it. If you get hurt in a dream, you wake up. You might have noticed in dream when there's going to be a very terrible thing going to happen to you, that's the time when you wake up. You're just about to fall and hurt yourself, you wake up. And therefore, there is something in that movie where when you can hurt yourself, you have the ability to wake up. And I said, that's so similar to us here. Only when we are hurt, when we are not happy with this universe, we become seekers. When we are happy, we don't seek anything. We just seek more of this world, which is giving us happiness. There are some people who feel we are very happy, but only temporarily. One man came to me, he said, you are telling us to go to some higher state of a reality. I am very happy with this reality. I have a very nice house, I've got a lot of money, I've got a good income, and I've got a nice car standing, you can see it outside. I've got every luxury of the world, I'm enjoying my life. Why should I go inside? I said, don't go inside, enjoy your life. Your time is not for going inside, your time is to enjoy what you have. And he left. Next week he was back. He said, my life is the worst in the world. I said, what happened in the last 1 week? No, I didn't tell you. My wife ran away with somebody else, leaving me so injured. I did so much for her. I loved her so much. I can't stop crying. I said, do you see that? Your beautiful car outside, all the money in your bank cannot solve this problem of what you're feeling emotionally now. Our lives are built like this here. Our lives are not happy lives. It can be happy in one segment and not in the other. Especially in these two segments, that which is obvious other people can see and that which cannot be seen. Emotions cannot be seen. That you are crying inside cannot be seen. You have a car can be seen. That you have some riches you can be seen. In my own life, I've seen the richest people that I've met are so sad, unfortunately, in their emotional and personal lives. And the poorest people I've met are so happy, singing songs and working in the gardens of Vrindavan in India, just singing the songs of Krishna. I've seen such poor people, couldn't afford meals, so happy. The richest people, so sad and morose. So therefore, there's a division between the tangible and the intangible experience of life. The tangible are what can be seen by others also. People think they must be very happy. Look at these Hollywood stars, for example. We see them in movies. Must be very happy people. They're famous, rich and famous people. Go and see their personal lives. I've had a chance to see so many of them. Terrible lives of unhappiness, sadness, disappointments. That is why the life in this physical world has not been designed for happiness, nor for unhappiness. It's designed for both, a combination. Also, it's not a place where we can be in one state of being all the time. We move from one state to another in this life, designed like that. The reason is, there are many forms of life we are going through. This human form is only one form. There are, according to the Indian scriptures, 8.4 million, 84 lakh, 8.4 million forms of life available. Those forms also include angels and other forms at higher levels of awareness than the physical. They include all of them. And those forms, the list of them, 5.4 million are in the plant kingdom. And they lie in the forest and under the oceans. And they are lying in different places. And then there are so many other forms of life. Only in the last list of 400,000, a human being appears. And a human life is considered to be different from all the remaining, 8.4 million forms of life, because it says this is the only form where we have a mind that thinks it can decide what to do. It can deliberate and has the experience of free will. One form, no other form. Other forms of life, living by their pre-programmed DNA instincts. Human form, questioning. I can decide, no matter what my instinct says, no matter what it is. If my destiny says this, I'll do something else. Somebody wrote to me yesterday. He said, we have true free will. Supposing you tell me this is my destiny, I'll do the opposite of that. I said, when you will go up, you will see what was written there, millions of years earlier, that you will tell me, I can change my destiny. Destiny will say this, I will do that. This thing was written millions of years earlier, your statement. What you actually do is what is written. That is why it's a big error to think that destiny is, can you read the destiny? Not here. But you can read it where you can read all destinies at the causal plane. Your destiny, everybody's destiny, the whole creation. If you see the destinies, they are being manufactured there. Destinies are manufactured there. So therefore, you can see how they're made up and how we just play out here. The destinies that are made out include our experience of so-called free will. How we will decide something is pre-written. It's an experience given to us to make us feel we have free will. Experience is generally one of free will because we don't know the future. If future was known, there'd be no free will. In the other level, future is known. Therefore, there's no free will. In plant life, animal life, they're all going according to instinctive things built into them. Therefore, there's no question of deliberation. Should I do it or should I not do it? They don't think like that. Human beings think like that. And why is that? Because this is the only window open from this whole creation, from where we can seek and go back home. Seeking cannot take place if you have no experience of free will. That is why seeking is connected with free will. And then it's also a little bit mixed up with searching for things. Searching, seeking, two English words. Searching is a mental activity. Seeking, spiritual. We are seeking something without knowing what we are seeking. We say, I know I'm looking for something, I don't know what it is, but there is something in me, spirit speaking. Well, I'm searching for the answer to my question. Mind speaking. So that is why it is built into us that we use so-called free will, which is an actual experience of free will. But it operates within the destiny prewritten. You can't change it by sitting here. You can change it from there. Over here, it will operate like we are making decisions right now. No way to know whether this change of decision that we are making was pre-written or not. Go there, it was pre-written. So that is why. But why this illusion of free will been given to us? So that we can seek and find the truth. It's one of the ways set up by us so that we can discover the truth. When we seek, a perfect living master appears. Supposing we seek less, a master appears, but not a perfect living master. It does not mean that the perfect living master appears straight away. Over several lifetimes, we could have several masters, each one taking us to the level to which our seeking can go. When the seeking goes beyond what we have got, and ultimately, we are tired of even the speaking part, as we have discovered with those masters, a perfect living master appears in our life. Perfect living masters are very rare. Great master used to say, even in this age, when we have more masters than before, there may not be more than the number of fingers that we can count on our hands in the whole universe. So that is why it's a rare experience to have a perfect living master come into our life. But he will come if we are seeking beyond the mind. No question about it. How will he know where we are situated, where we are seeking, if he's just a human being like us? He's an ordinary human being like us. Awareness of our seeking, awareness of what we are seeking, and aware of what we are together in the ultimate place. Perfect living masters are like us. No difference. They born like us, they die like us, they fall sick like us, they eat like us. They do everything exactly like us. One difference only. Their awareness is constant of all the levels of creation. When we want to rise in our awareness, when we practice meditation to rise in awareness, we go stage by stage, one stage by stage. We do not see two realities together. It's only in totality that you see all realities together. Anything below is only one reality at one time. That is why we dream, this reality disappears. We wake up, this reality, only reality. We go to astral stage, this disappears. Only reality. Causal stage, only reality. Everything else is unreal. We go to the beyond, in the spiritual region. The soul is the only reality. But there are many souls. Not one. We go to totality of consciousness beyond the spiritual regions. The spiritual region has been called Parabrahm. The Brahm being the limit of the mind. It is beyond the limit of the mind. The Parabrahm has soul. Soul originates from there. You become immortal. You discover your immortality. Time and space disappear when you are at that stage. But that's not the end of the journey for a perfect living master. End of the journey is where there is only one soul. All souls are manifestation of one. So that is why when you are a manifestation only of one and you reach the awareness of the one, you are aware of all realities, why they have been created and how they exist, and you can be operating at all of them. Perfect living masters whom we meet in this life, they are operating at all the levels of realities and they are aware of all the levels of reality. They are not those who have seen something inside during meditation and come to us to tell us what they saw. They are seeing what they are telling us when they are talking to us. When they talk to us, at that time they are conscious of all of these things. So that is why their speech is different from the speech of learned people who have learned a lot of books, or people who have had very big experiences, but only as seekers of the experience, they come back and share their experience with us. Perfect living masters are beyond that. They are having the experiences we are talking about, the reality we are talking about, at all times, simultaneously. That is why when they talk to us, there are no maybes and perhapses in their talks. They talk with certainty. When I was reading the Bible, that Sermon on the Mount impressed me. Because after Jesus had given the Sermon on the Mount, the Bible says, there was a hush upon the multitude. For he spake like one with authority and not like the scribes. That's the difference. He spoke like he knew what I was speaking about. He was speaking from there, not remembering what he had seen sometimes in meditation. That's the difference between masters who have had experiences and share with us, and a perfect living master who is sharing something he is having when he's sharing with us. Big difference. So that is why when we are ready for that, the perfect living master appears. To summarize, the mind can take us up to the causal plane. The sound can take us beyond. Love and devotion can take us to a truth. And these are built into the system. When we are ready for it, it automatically happens. What do we need to do to get this? Only one thing. Seek inside with love and devotion. Meditate with your mind, but with love and devotion. Do everything. Do seva with love and devotion. Remember, never give up love and devotion if you want to be truly on a spiritual path. That's the secret I wanted to share with you. Thank you very much. We'll break now for lunch. I'll see you in the afternoon again, about 3 o'clock.